Alright, we're going through the book of Acts. We are going on chapter 2. Last week, we just started a book of Acts, but I couldn't quite finish the sermon. I'll just give you a brief outline of it. You know, this book of Acts is, you know, we see that's a continuation of the Luke. I mean, this same author. And it shows a lot of things. It talks about the journey of a Christian. That how once they become a Christian, what it looks like when they go into the world. And it speaks personally, challenges me a lot, because a lot of times that I see God theologically, but I never live out my life theologically. I think God theologically, but I don't know how to bring this God, the way I understand God, into my life, into my marriage, into my raising kids, into my ministry. And Book of Acts really give us the clear example when a person be touched by the gospel, message of the gospel, what it should happen, what it should look like. And do you want to find that out? Yeah? I mean, that's what we want to apply into our life as well. So, I said last week, the chapter 2 is very, very important because it changes everything. It changes the direction. I mean, not change the direction. It's more like it forms the foundation of the whole book of Acts. Holy Spirit came, and that was promised. Jesus says that wait, and Holy Spirit will come. And that's the point, the book of chapter 2, Acts of chapter 2, saying the Holy Spirit came. And from there on, all the disciples, all the believers, whether they were the witnesses of the resurrection of the friends of Jesus and all that, their life is completely changed. And I shared it with you last week, yeah? This is the only way you and I can act like Christian. This is the only way you and I can live like a follower of Jesus Christ. There's no way that we can do this by our own sheer willpower, by all our own desire. I mean, how many of you guys fail just because, oh, I'm committed to this. I want to do this. I want to live my life for God. But sooner or later, how many of you guys really, really struggling and failing again and again and again, you know? Answer to that is Holy Spirit. Just, you know, when the Holy Spirit came, the people started speaking in tongues, and, you know, and we suspect this, that the upper room is actually bigger because 120 people were there, and they started speaking in tongues. There's three kind of people there. We can categorize the one who actually filled with the Holy Spirit, and the people were amazed. What is this? They're questioning about it, and some of the people were skeptical about it. You know, exactly the same thing that's happening in the church these days, yeah? What we really need is that it's not just temporary sensation. It's not dry informational comprehension. I think what God wants is the authentic transformation. That's why God gave us Holy Spirit. That's why Holy Spirit is needed in our life. It's not just so emotion. Like, how many of you guys been to, what's the concert that just happened? Adele, right? I've seen the 90,000 people, they're worshiping Adele right there, right? And then they're all excited, like, yeah, you know, they're loving it, and all they're shouting, and they're saying amen to everything Adele said, all that stuff. But it was a great sensation. But Christianity is not just a sensation. It's just a momentary things that we go through. Do not think that it's a way that you're being filled with the Holy Spirit. Or it's not just a comprehension either, just because you know the biblical certain words or information. It's not that. It's not the sign that you are filled with the Holy Spirit. Being filled with the Holy Spirit is actually complete changes of inner self. Just complete changes of who you are is an authentic transformation. Well, in fact, Holy Spirit is important, not because He's only the one who helps us to live our Christian life, but also because Bible finally speaks to us, Trinity God, God who is a Trinity. The God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. All right, just can I pause? I mean, I think the PowerPoint doesn't follow me at all. Yeah, is the PowerPoint ready? Can you give me a thumbs up if you're ready? Wow, that's not it. All right, that's fine. The next one is important. So, but I just want to, that's it, yeah. And next one, I just want to have a pause and I'll just explain a bit, just a little bit of our understanding of this this first part of the chapter 2. It's about the speaking in tongue. People start to speaking in tongue. And back then, this time, everybody speaking in tongue that actually someone else's language. And the Holy Spirit came, one of the first signs was the speaking in tongue. And how do we take this? How do we understand this? And if you're wondering, this is my official theological understanding as our church and as this, in this church. And I can't explain every details of it, but I just want to just run down these 5 points here. Number one, tongue has an important place in the devotional life of the believer. I believe in that. Speaking in tongue has an important place in devotional life. I speak in tongue in my devotional prayer. Number two, when tongues are practiced in the corporate life of church, it must be carefully controlled and never without interpretation given by the Holy Spirit. It's from the Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 14, 27 to 28. Basically, don't speak in tongues. Basically, don't grab the microphone and say, oh, I got to speak in tongues, blah, 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 you know. And no one can understand this, and that's not what God wants. That's not how you use the speaking in tongues. Verse 3, the ability to pray in an unknown tongue is not a gift given to every believer. Okay, let me just want to lay out there. Bible actually says it's not everybody, for everyone, yeah? Some of you will not have it. Some of you have it. But in my experience, most of you can have it. That's my belief, right? But Bible says it's not every, but for everyone. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 20. John Piper, for example, he says he doesn't speak in tongue, but he wants to speak in tongue, but he can't, right? So that's it. Verse 4, the ability to pray in an unknown tongue is not the evidence of the filling of the Holy Spirit. This is a funny thing, isn't it? In itself cannot be the sign of the whole filling of the Holy Spirit. Filling of the Holy Spirit is being filled with the Holy Spirit. Just because you're speaking in tongue, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're filled with the Holy Spirit. Well, if you read the Galatians, it will tell you the sign of being filled with the Holy Spirit, the life that you are living under the control of the Holy Spirit is fruit of the Holy Spirit. And there are things that we need to talk, go a bit deeper than just superficial, just symptoms of that. But speaking in tongues is very important. Number 5. And 1 Corinthians chapter 14, 5. Although it's not the only evidence, the evidence of being filled with the Holy Spirit, but Bible says, the Apostle Paul said, I want you to speak in tongues. Yeah? And then he says, of course, but I want you to prophesy more. But I want to just set it up here before. I want you to speak in tongues. If you want to speak in tongues, ask for it. Even today, during the sermons, during the prayer, ask God. I've seen it so many times. The people receive in tongue, and some of the girls are still remember speaking in tongue, and once started and can't stop. And during the sermon service and all that, and after worship finishes, she has to go home and she can't stop it. It's like, oh, there was crazy. She wasn't speaking in tongue, so she came to me, and I knew that she wants to stop. So I prayed for her to stop speaking in tongue, and suddenly stopped it. So I don't have a gift giving people speaking in tongue. But I have a gift of stopping people speaking in tongues. And I pray with her. And there are actually several occasions in my life. And personally, just personally, when I don't know how to pray, when I just sit around and I have to always, like, how to bring this to God. My knowledge is not good enough. I don't know. My tongue is not good enough. I just pray in tongue. My emotion is not good. For example, some of the mothers is really sick, so they're going through cancer treatment and all that. I don't know how to pray for the person. What do I do? I go to God and pray in tongues. So, okay, what else can I do? I pray, of course, God, would you heal her? But that's one sentence. That's all. One 2 seconds, my prayer will be finished. But my emotion is go deeper than that. My emotion way more than that. But his prayer is about articulating what you need to say and just somehow persuade God and just twist God's arm. No, it's not. It's about connecting with God. And God, you know my heart. Listen to my heart. I am actually really, really sad for this person. Would you heal her? And my word is not good enough. So sometimes I repeat the word, would you heal her? Would you heal her? Would you heal her? Because I can't really think of any other words, right? And then naturally, I start to speak in tongue and powerfully. Delivers me from this burden to make my case known to God. Speaking tongue actually powerful effect. So please, as the Bible says, I want you to speak in tongue. Yeah? Speak in tongue. When I turn somebody sitting next to you, receive the Holy Spirit and speak in tongue. No, don't do that. It sounds very heretic right there. All right. We need to go on from that moment where Holy Spirit came and people start to amaze. And what's going on? They were asking, what is this? What's going on? And then someone said, some people said, they must be drunk. They must be drunk. And then the Peter has to stand up and explain this. Now, I think this rest of the passage really clearly shows us what are the effects of being filled with the Holy Spirit. Okay, my aim of this sermon is this. I want you to really desire listening this passage, and I want you to really walking out or staying there desiring being filled with the Holy Spirit. Because these are the effects of being filled with the Holy Spirit. What? And why am I emphasizing filling of the Holy Spirit? Well, Henry Brackovich says, will God ever ask you to do something you are not able to do? The answer is yes, all the time. It must be the way for God's glory and kingdom if we function according to our ability. Can I have a PowerPoint, please? And ability alone, we get the glory. If we function according to the power of the Spirit within us, God gets the glory. He wants to reveal himself to a watching world. Now, the reason that you and I need to be filled with the Holy Spirit is because what we are talking about is it's humanly impossible. It's humanly absolutely impossible. And I am actually standing here before you. That I confess before you that I need to be filled with the Holy Spirit to do what I need to do. Even preaching it, I need the Holy Spirit. You need the Holy Spirit. Leading the life group, living out your journey, feeding the homeless, but you need the Holy Spirit in your life. And that's why you need to fill with the Holy Spirit. If you are struggling for any reason, you know, if you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you get less resentful. I've seen that. If you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you get less offended, you get less insecure, you get less less guilty, and all sorts of the things that the enemy is speaking to you. If you need to feel, you're less angry, you are more forgiving, and somehow the answer to all those problems that we're going through is being filled with the Holy Spirit. And I can say straight up. If you are not really connect with God, one of the biggest reasons is because you are not filled with the Holy Spirit. And all these people, the apostles and the disciples, remember, these guys are the ones who seen Jesus twice. They connect with Jesus. They saw him resurrected and walk around. But even those people need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Yeah? So desire to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And Paul Washer says this, I used to tell young preacher, in order to preach, you got to have the power of God on your life. Now I tell them, in order to tie your shoes, you got to have the power of God on your life. This church needs to be way more than this. And how do you do it? Filled with the Holy Spirit. And what does it look like? What? How do we be filled with the Holy Spirit? And that is the passage we're about to read. I'm sorry. I have 3 points. What's the effect of the Holy Spirit? Being filled with the Holy Spirit. Boldness in preaching the gospel. Devotion to the word and prayer. Extraordinary fellowship and giving. That's the next passage, yeah? So, okay, number one. So when these people say that what's going on? And the way the apostle Peter says this, we are not drunk. It's not about being drunk. It's not, you know, for those people who are skeptical. He just stood up and said, hey, there is a reason behind this. So he's explaining it. Yeah? That's verse 14. Let me read to you. But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them. Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give ear to my words. For these people are not drunk, as you suppose, since it's only the third hour of the day. So he said, hey, for those people who are skeptical, you know what? They are not drunk. And let me tell you what's happening here. And he was saying that everything that is happening, you're seeing these weird things happening around you right now. The people, you probably know them, yeah? The people that this doing this like crazy things, going speaking different language, although they didn't learn that, it's because it's something that already spoken to you through the Old Testament. This is what was promised. Verse 16. But this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel, right? And in the last days it shall be, God declares that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and all your son and your daughter shall prophesy, your young man shall see visions, and your old man shall dream dreams. Even on my male servants and female servants, in those days I will pour out my spirit and they shall prophesy. And I show wonders in the heavens above and signs on earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So Peter, as he explaining this phenomenon before the people, he basically quoting the Old Testament and telling them, this is actually fulfilled right now. It's being fulfilled here. And mind you, who are this audience that he's speaking to right now? They are the God-fearing Jewish or non-Jewish people surrounding and asking this, what's going on? And he's saying that this is act of God. This is something God already has promised for a long time ago, and it finally has arrived. It is happening right now. And through the prophets of Joel, this is what was promised. And also, the main point was this, the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord, yeah? This is the day that we've been waiting for. And this is one of the signs that you are waiting for. And I'm telling you, this is what God has done for these people. And then he says, this promise, what we are seeing, this sign is actually about Jesus Christ. The funny thing is about this. This Jesus is not someone complete stranger. It's not Jesus someone that they don't know. You know, this Jesus is someone they already heard about him. It's about someone not long ago, he crucified him. It's very big news, like not long ago, and the president got impeached. Literally like that, no one missed that. You know, everybody remembers where they were when they heard the news. Oh, Korean president impeached. And this Jesus is very well known by them because of the scandalous, uproar and crucifying. Maybe some of them saying this, were there, hearing this message, were one of those people who crucified Jesus. And this is Peter saying, verse 22, man of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, the man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as yourselves know. See, as you know, you've seen his miracle. You've seen his signs and wonders, yeah? And those men, that was Jesus Christ. This Jesus delivered up according to the definite time and foreknown knowledge of God. See, as it said, it's actually about God's plan, prophesied long before. You crucified and killed by the hands of the lawless man. God raised him up, losing the pangs of death because it was not possible for him to be held. See? And now, basically, the Peter was saying that, well, do you know these signs, wonders, of speaking tongue, all that, is actually about Jesus. And this Jesus that you killed, right? And he, on top of that, he's saying, this Jesus didn't just die. You saw him die, but he actually rose again. Now, this is a very critical theological point that Peter is making. Without this message, Christianity cannot survive. Christianity do not have a message that saves the world. What is it? The message of resurrection. Message of a resurrection. See, a lot of our scholars saying the book of Acts is not just of the crucifixion. It's a story of resurrection. Resurrection is a key part of the whole life journey of Christians. So he explained this. You killed him, but he rose again. You killed him, but he rose again. Verse 29, brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David, again, he goes back to the Old Testament, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us ordered us to this day, being there for a prophet and knowing that God has shown with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne. So the Jesus being the descendant of David, verse 31, he foresaw, spoke about the resurrection of the Christ. And he was not abandoned to the Hades, nor did he flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we all are witnesses, being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out that you yourself are seeing and hearing. Here you go. So he's basically explaining. And through the explaining, as he explained, what he's doing? He's preaching Jesus. He is the witness of Jesus throughout all the last 3 years. And now he received the Holy Spirit. I think, until he actually received the Holy Spirit, he didn't really get it. What was all this about? Holy Spirit finally came and explained to them. Remember how Peter was before? He denied Jesus several times. And he ran away. And that Peter, who saw the Jesus turning the water into wine and crazy, like Jesus walking water, and all sorts of experience, all sorts of witnessing is not good enough until he received the Holy Spirit in his life and changed everything and stood up and to the people and saying, this Jesus is your Lord and Savior, right? This is the reason, my friend, you and me, I need Holy Spirit. I need the Holy Spirit. And I'm not Jesus. And I'm not good enough. And I'm not strong enough. I'm not wise enough in all sorts of places. I can confess to you that I cannot do this without Holy Spirit. And exactly it's what Peter is going through. Somehow it clicks. Somehow it makes sense. Somehow he starts to have this power and understanding that he didn't have before Holy Spirit came and start to see this. This Jesus is someone that prophesies. And what you see here, speaking in tongues and all that, is because who Jesus was. And this Jesus was rose again. Well, you know what? Why resurrection is so important? Because of resurrection and the death. Death is our final frontier and our worst curse in our life, isn't it? Everything that we do, we're trying to do it to avoid the death. And our friends can make fun of people who are trying to live out their Christian journey in a very, very timid way. Like, our biggest wish is some Christian live out their journey the bar, trying to balance it and trying to balance it and try not to fall. And this is how you live. You don't do any tumbling. You don't do any somersault there. You don't play. You don't jump and all that. Just make sure you don't fall and just hold on to the bar. And make sure you don't fall. And when the last day, the greatest wish that you have is that when you die, I don't feel anything. And I feel safe. I might die in my sleep. It's like my son asking me randomly, Dad, do you want to die in the sun or die in the ocean? You want to get drowned or burned to death? I don't know why he was thinking. So basically, the greatest wish is that, okay, let's just live on because I know I'm going to heaven. And one day, let's just pass from the life and just, whoop, yay, I'm dead. Imagine the guy who live out the whole life and performing their life and doing this and stand before the Lord going, going this. That's not how we should live. What Bible is saying is the moment, the very first day of Christianity, the very first day of the church, he preached the gospel, and through the resurrection, this Jesus rose again from the dead. If this Jesus rose again from the dead, so shall you. So do not fear the death. The death is nothing. That's got nothing on you, right? Because it's got nothing on Jesus. Resurrection becomes the powerful, the most important message of the mankind. Now, what happens after that is that people were asking, responding to this message, right before that. So through this Jesus was resurrected and all this. In conclusion, what is it? He said, let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, the Jesus whom you crucified. He is the Lord and crucified. Do you know how astonishing that message is? Do you know how crazy that message is? basically saying Jesus rose again. He's resurrected man, the man who conquered the death that you fear the most, the man who answered for our lives because he conquered the death, right? And he's saying that this Jesus was a Christ. And in Jewish people's mind, they know what Christ means. They know what this the person who Messiah means in their life. He's the one they've been waiting for. He's saying, Jesus was the one. The one that you crucified was the Lord and the Christ. Church, Jesus cannot be the Savior if he can't be your Lord. Does it make sense? From the day one, the way the gospel was preached, this, he never distinguished, okay, Jesus can be your Savior. He can save you. He can take care of you. He can take you to heaven. But you don't necessarily have to follow him. How many of us have that kind of mentality? How many of us love him being Savior in our life, but you never want him to be your Lord? You still want to control your life. You still want to have say over your life always. And I am what I am. I get what I get, right? That attitude is not really the message of the gospel. Basically, Peter was saying that he, that you crucified, is both Lord and Christ. Both the Lord and Christ. He's the Lord of you. Okay, now, this moment to be real here. This moment to be real. Okay. I'm going to say something very, very harsh. I said it before, but I'm going to say it again just in case you forget because I don't trust you remembering my sermon anyway. Some of you may not be a Christian. You may not be a Christian. You just think you are. Just because you agree intellectually, religiously, Jesus, I believe in you. You get baptized, but Jesus never be the Lord of your life. You can't have half of Jesus. I hope you get offended right now. I hope you don't like what I said today. That is way better than you have this, yeah, okay, whatever, and walk away from this lukewarm-hearted. Today, I'd rather you be cold or hot. That's what because the first gospel message preached to us is that Jesus is the Lord, what? And Christ. He's a Savior. And Christ, the anointed one, also he's the Lord. Jesus is like that. There's no compromise. And the response. This response is crazy. How did the people respond? Verse 37. Okay. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. They were cut to the heart. Do you see the expression here? When was the last time your heart was cut? It was just cut to the, it just penetrated your heart. It just deeply touched you. It shake you. It bothered you. It really literally shake you up and just like upside down, right? So it cut you. It hurt you so much because it cut you. And right into your heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, the question that they ask is, brother, what shall we do? Shall we do? I think this is one missing element of this modern-day Christianity. You don't ask this question anymore. We don't ask this question anymore. You just want to come and receive and give me, give me, give me, give me God, right? You don't want to change anything about you and you just, God, just fulfill my dream. God, give me what I want. You will never really ask. We forgot how to ask this question. We need to come to God. If gospel is true, he's my Lord and my Christ. And same as me, if Holy Spirit convicting my heart, right now what I need to do is, God, what should I do? I cannot go on anymore like this. I cannot move on. Just so little of you in my life. I cannot be satisfied just like the way I am anymore. I need you to fill my life. I need to show me what should I do. I want to cut out the things that you don't want me to do in my life. But I'm still wrestling with it. I'm struggling. What should I do? You know, you're sitting there. My heart is so dry, so numb. What should I do? What do you do normally? You either ignore it. You think there's normality in your life. Or you blame someone else. You blame someone else. It's someone else's fault. It must be someone else's fault. It's like Pastor Joshua's fault. It must be my church's fault. It's my friend's fault. It's my parents' fault. But we don't ask this question. The question you really ask is to God, to the people, what should I do? What does it take for me to understand this Christ in my life? Man, I'm sorry. I'm just lost. I was preparing, and I was just like weeping in my heart. I said, God, as a Christian, that as a person who already received Jesus, Lord and Savior, I'm not desperate enough to know God more. This job, pastor, I'm a pastor, so I should know the more than anyone here in the church. And some of these positions secure me because people see me a holy person anyway already. You know, I already so close to God, people think. So I don't get to this ask question, what should I do in my life? But honestly, standing before you, there are times I'm drained, I'm disillusioned, and I just struggling with God. God, I can't do this anymore. I do that. What do I do there? What do I do there? You tell me, what do I do there as a Christian, fellow Christian? I, on my knee, ask God, you got to fill me. You got to do what you want to do in my life first. I can't do this on my own. I can't be a good father without you fill my heart. I can't be a good husband without being filled with the Holy Spirit. This effect of Holy Spirit, right, is the clarity of gospel comes just like that. And the boldness of preaching the gospel. If Jesus is this, I got nothing to lose here. I got nothing to hide. And I'm going to preach to you. Jesus rose again. And he's Lord and Savior. How would you answer that? Church, how would you answer that? When was the last time you asked this question? What shall I do? And Peter answered this way, verse 38. Listen carefully. You can forget of all the sermon I preached, but this is the main point here. Verse 38, he says, Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children, for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. And with many other words, he bore witness and continued to exhort him, saying, save yourself from this crooked generation. So those who received his word were baptized, and there were added a day about 3,000 souls. So Peter's answer was this, repent. Everybody says, repent. I don't want you to say it lightly, okay? Because you heard it so many times. I don't want you to say it lightly right now. You know the meaning of repent? A lot of people think that repentance is being sorry about or being feel guilty about certain things, so I repent. No, no, no. Actual word, repent, the Greek word is metanoia. Meta, changing, transforming. Noia is knowledge. Basically, your mind is changed. Your worldview is changed. You're complete transformed. Your idea of the world is changed. So what I'm saying is this. When you repent, Holy Spirit comes, you start to repent, right? That's when you happen, there's something that changes in you. So you start to see the things that you valued before not valuable anymore. Something that you see the more priority in your life is not priority anymore. Something that you actually put first in your life is not first anymore. The worldview has changed. I've seen a lot of young girls here. Okay, I'm talking to a lot of young girls. So many young girls messed up their life because they hoping around one boyfriend after another. All right? I'm telling you early enough. Don't laugh at this. I'm very serious about it. Because it's very natural for you to want to feel significant. So you always want to feel someone in your life, the most significant thing. Oh, the most priority is there. But when the Holy Spirit comes, what happens? When you repent, that person that's sitting next to you or the person that is so attractive is not your priority anymore. The people who are working, you're having a house or getting a car and all those things, your priority before is not your priority anymore. Something changes in you. Oh, some of you have addiction. Pornographic addiction. I know some of you, even last night you watched something, right? And you're standing here feeling guilty, or even you're already numb about it. I'm telling you, because Holy Spirit is telling you right now in your heart, you need to have this cut in your heart and repent. That's all you need to do, yeah? What happened? Then those kind of attraction is not attractive anymore. Repent, the metanoia happens. For those people who have a hatred and unforgiveness in your heart. And when the repentance, the metanoia comes, what happens? That you have this different priority and you understand God has forgiven me, so I got no reason not to forgive anyone in this world. Metanoia. Repent and be baptized. Be completely submerged into the unity with the Christ. That's what happens. Every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins. And God will forgive you. And listen to this. Then what happened? And you will receive the gift of Holy Spirit. Right now, I'm going to conclude here. The crucial question today, maybe some of you, is this. Then, Pastor Joshua, how do I receive Holy Spirit? Yeah? Answer to that is, I don't know. Because Holy Spirit, theologically, is not someone that I can control. There's no formula you can just go through. And there's no ritual that you can just make God to do what you want Him to do. Does that make sense? That's the bottom line. But number two, there's something that you need to do before repentance. Repentance, what happened? And then says a forgiveness of sin. So you repent your sin. You are completely surrendered to something else and you cannot expect the Holy Spirit coming into your life. That's what the Bible says. Holy Spirit cannot share your life, your heart, your spirit with something else. It's either whole Holy Spirit or nothing or something else. If you are serving the world, if you are actually addicted to something, you are sinning constantly, you need to repent today. If you are proud, you have a proud in your heart, there's a reason that you cannot receive the Holy Spirit. And you come before God. And number three, what happens? Ask God humbly. God, what should I do? What should I do with my life? And Bible says, this God is generous. He's not stringent. Like, He's not the kind of God like, I don't want to give you Holy Spirit. No, if you sincerely ask God, and God will fill you with the Holy Spirit. Amen? That's all I know. That's all I know. And I've been living out my life that way too. And I want you to experience that too. I really want you to experience that. I mean, I can preach like the next 10 hours from here. Believe me, I can. You don't want me to, but I can, right? But it will not make any difference in your life if you don't receive the Holy Spirit. If you don't feel the Holy Spirit. Okay, just two theological remarks right there. This is important. Baptism of the Holy Spirit. If you read the Wayne Grudem, that's the theological stand that we come from. We call that New Calvinism, basically saying that I believe the baptism of the Holy Spirit is different to being filled with the Holy Spirit. Baptism of the Holy Spirit happens when you receive the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. You can't receive Jesus without Holy Spirit. Amen? That's when the baptism happens. You completely submerge into it. And that newborn baby needs to be filled with the Holy Spirit consistently. Now what I see some of you guys, you are Christian. You are actually united with Christ, but you're still trying to do it with your own strength, with your own idea, with your own power. And you are not trying to really let God really lead your life. You don't know what you're missing out. And you are too smart for Holy Spirit. You're too good for Holy Spirit. You're just too good at teaching. You don't know that you are not desiring God in your life. Yeah? Do you know what I'm saying? And I wish I can just put my heart out and chuck it at you. Do you see what I'm trying to say here? You need the Holy Spirit. You need God. How can we be so settled with the little of God in our life? Don't you think it's something wrong with our life, isn't it? Yeah. As a Christian followers of Jesus Christ, we are actually okay. Just God, I just want to have a little bit of something somehow that I can manageable. I just pray a bit. I come to church a bit. I read the Bible a bit, but don't ask me too much. There's something so wrong about that whole attitude. The reason is because you are not being filled with the Holy Spirit. It happens to me too, man. It happens to me. If I'm not filled with the Holy Spirit, I have all sorts of crazy ideas in my head. I start to have this unknown hatred. I have this all sorts of unknown that pride. It just comes up. What do I do then? Then I learn how to cut down all the distraction. Number one, I try to read the Bible. Number two, I try to listen to the word of God in the song. So I sing. When you sing, there's something happens in you, right? That's why we have a music around you. I sing, right? Sometimes I walk and just talk to God. I just make God, I need you to be the center of my life. And I can just go, I can't go on pretend that I'm a pastor without you. Church. We've been doing this for 3 years with you. And as pastor, I sincerely apologize to you if you're not growing in this church. And I want you to understand, I really, really love you, but there are limitations of, as a pastor, I can't love you. Absolutely honest with you, I can't love you. I don't even know your name. I can't pretend I got the answer. But I know who has the answer. And that's why we are here today. Don't go home without getting that answer. Don't go home without wanting that answer. That is Jesus. Jesus, you need Jesus. You need Jesus in your life a bit more. And Holy Spirit will let you know that. So we sing this song, More of You, Less of Me. More of you, less of me. Can we sing as if we really mean it, yeah? And Holy Spirit, cut to your heart. And we ask God, how can I do? What should I do to have it more and less of me in my life? Holy Spirit, come and fill my life. Let's pray.